Mr. Rajan Venkatesh has been involved with for the last 4 years. It's somewhere near Mussoorie, if I'm not mistaken. Basically there are students, teachers, they should be, it will be a lot of interest to you. We have here Ms. Teresa Almeida, who is a known educationist. She started an experiment called Manovikas in Madgaon, and even after her retirement as a principal, she continued as a director of that. Recently she has retired as a director, but when I was talking to her, I realized that she had just retired, but she is not tired. She was telling me what else needs to be done in education, what experiments are needed in education, and the people who are doing experiments are completely neglected. And that's why we are honoring a person here with a book launch, Mr. Rajan Venkatesh, who is basically a journalist. He has worked in Bombay and Delhi as a journalist, but then he has been touring all over the country, in rural areas especially. And now he has started a school, which is a Bodhishala, and this book, which is going to be launched today here, he is learning at Bodhishala. What is this experiment? And this book is being released by one person whom we know very little as a publisher, and more we know him as an enemy of all the politicians, enemy of all the mine owners, enemy of all the builders, Dr. Claude Alvarez, and friend of all the girls who want to preserve our nature, our environment. And like Tony Martin said, that a leading environmentalist, director of Goa Foundation. I am personally a fan of Dr. Claude Alvarez, not as an environmentalist, not as a publisher, but basically as a journalist. I grew up in my student days reading Claude's articles in Sunday Observer and also in other newspapers. And I still remember his cover page story in Illustrated Weekly on white lie on the milk revolution, which exposed the whole scam which was going on. It was in somewhere in the 80s, if I am not mistaken. And since then, I'm really Claude's fan. But Claude comes here as a publisher, the Other India Book Service, which they are running. They have published many books, and this book is published by them. Before Claude takes over, I once again request you, whoever is interested in translations, there's an excellent translation workshop tomorrow, which is conducted by Mini Krishnan, who is the editor of translations of Oxford University Press. So it will be from 10 to 12, for which if you are interested, you have to go and register yourself, because there are very limited seats. You have to go and register yourself at the office. So I request Claude to take over. Thank you.
The book that we are trying to release today is of a different type of a school. It's a school where there was joy, where there was creativity, there was freedom for the students, and they also learned something. And most important, they linked up with the people, their families, and the community from which they came. So the school was a part of the community. It helped the community, and the community helped the school in return, because the community also has got knowledge. School also has got knowledge. Both by interacting, we have something new. So I am going to ask, we are going to release the book only at the end, not before. And I am going to ask Therese, you know Therese, Therese, everybody in Goa knows her. She has been running Manovikas, associated with Manovikas now for 45 years, before most of you were born, practically all of you were born. From that, 1969 she has been running also. And it is the only school in Goa which is different from the other schools. Everybody knows that also. So if she, I asked her to read this book and come for this meeting. So she has read the book. So as a person who is involved in education, learning, teaching, schooling for 45 years, I think it would be good if we get from her mouth what she feels about the book. Therese.
I want to thank Claude for giving me the opportunity to read this book. And I want to thank Venkatesh for writing it and for living it.
Rajan Venkatesh, who has written this book, has lived the book. And what I would like to tell you is that he has gone out of his way, left his comfort zone, went into the Himalayas and went to work in a school for village children. What he began to discover was that the learning that the children had to do had little to do with their lives. And so he decided to reintroduce the lives of the children into their learning. Wouldn't we all like to do that? That is what we all want, that our lives are not separate from our learning. But in most schools today, this is what we see. Don't look out of the window. Don't know what's happening outside. Just look at your book and listen to me. And so we sit and listen to somebody else, and we gather little tidbits of information, and we try to make sense out of it. But in this case, these children didn't do that. They went out into their village. They looked at everything around them. They looked at their food. They looked at their seeds. They looked at their climate. They looked at the things that made them work, that made work for them, for their parents. And they analyzed and judged and did all this themselves. And while doing it, they also learned science. They learned geography. They learned history. They learned about the world itself and their position in it. This was very important because now they were doing real learning, not first-hand learning as we call it, which we think should be done only in primary school or preschool. First-hand learning has to be there all the time, and it is possible to bring it about if teachers want to do it. So I congratulate Rajan on this. There are so many aspects here which I would like to touch upon. One of them is the idea of commonality and differentiation. All of us as children learn what is different, right? Every one of us looks at things and says, oh, this is different from that, that is different from this. We don't look and see what is common to everything. And this differentiation is then ingrained in us. And we look at things as, you know, levels of wealth, levels of caste, levels of color, all kinds of levels. And we categorize things like that. And that is why we cannot really have real equality. And I think in a society without equality, nothing can happen. Nothing can move. Children must experience equality. That is the most important thing for them. And this, I feel, he brings out very well in this book. Rajan has also used the village as his library, as his laboratory, as his manufacturing unit, and the thing to study. Even the seasons in it made a difference to his studies, to the children's studies. When they sowed, when they worked, what they did in winter, what they did in summer. Did they follow a routine? Did they follow rules? Or did they adapt the rules according to how the climate was? All this they studied. They learned to make different things. They used the forests around them to make medicinal plants, to look at plants, to study their medical values. And I read so many in the book that are so useful, and he's described them so well. They also sat down and studied their food, and then they also decided to use the grinders in the village to grind their own corn and flour. And this way, they started using that to put rotis in the kitchen, and they calculated the cost of what they were doing. They found that to make a biscuit using genuine ingredients costs a great deal more than the biscuits you buy in the market. Why is that? Why is it that these ingredients should cost more? It is because the market flour or wheat is pure maida. It is used as a, it is used with hydrogenated fats, not with ghee or butter. And it's mixed like that. And then it is made into biscuits, which are made very cheaply because it is subsidized wheat. Subsidized by government. So actually, the biscuits that are being sold in the market are available because the people are robbing the people from making them. So, you know, one learns all about these things when one studies in real life. The other aspect of this education is that besides being experiential, and it is integrated. It integrates all the learning into one kind of learning. So I would like to say that when we look at education today, most people don't care. They are, we're sending our children to school. What is happening in school? What is happening there? Nobody really knows. They're not even concerned about it. Exam pass zaleni, for example. But you know how to add, you know how to do this, that's very good. What did you get? Oh, you got a first class, very good. But after that, these students are coming out without skills, without knowledge, without being able to apply what they know, and they are quite helpless when they go into higher education. So people are not concerned. Now, I have been looking at education for a long time, and I discovered that there were places in the world where education was very, very meaningful. In the Himalayas with Venkatesh, in Italy, in a suburb called Reggio Emilia, where after World War II, a whole lot of people got together because their villages were completely ruined. They had nothing, no homes, no buildings, nothing. And they also had to go to work and they had children, small children. What do? So they decided to build their own school in this village. And they decided to work in the night because in the daytime they were working elsewhere. And what did they get for money? They found some horses and some guns and tanks left behind by the Germans, which they sold. They took the rubble from wherever they had it and they built their school. And they accessed people who would come and work there, to look after the babies, to look after the children who were up to the age of 10. And this experiment flowered until today. It is a worldwide movement which people go from Japan, America, everywhere to study. How is that these people are so effective with their primary school education? Because it means something to them. They are people who started this whole thing. They didn't leave it to the government or they didn't leave it to the education department. One of the worst things we have today is departments that make the rules. And they want us all to comply. Compliance is built into the system we live in, and it is wrong. Compliance is not what we were born for. We were born to be creative, to be able to learn, to be able to do, to be able to live well. If you're going to comply, you end up by joining a call center somewhere. And you look at technology as some like a god. Not something for you to use and useful to you, but technology guides what you are going to do, which is not right. So we have to be alert to all these things, to know that technology is not our master, but our servant. We have to ask if technology really works for us, or whether it works only for a few against the many. It must work for people. It must do good for society. It must have indivisible benefits for all. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Otherwise, we are living in a techno dump. So I would like to congratulate Venkatesh for writing this book, thank him for doing it well, thank you, Klaus, for having me here. I'm able to say so much, and I will now release the book. Anything you want to say?
I think we should hear Rajan Venkatesh on what exactly motivated him to run the school that he did. And that's that, and why did he spend, I mean, for somebody to spend 3 to 4 years of his life taking over an entirely new project, turning a school upside down, bringing huge amount of learning back, enthusiasm into the school, the children. Most children don't want to go to school. They're not eager to go to school. But in that school, everybody was eager. There was a great deal of things going on at the time. There were lots of things were happening, including interaction with monkeys and birds and trees and fruits and seeds and all that. It became a completely different exercise from what normal schools, you go to our classroom, it's like a traffic lights on the road. Every time you finish one green light, you come, then there's another red light. So then another period gets over. Then you finish that, you go to another red light, another period gets over. So learning takes place, you know, like traffic lights. It's the most useless way of learning, I can tell you, because learning never, you know, takes place in 15-minute periods or 30-minute periods or something. It's a very weird way of learning as far as I can see. But let us hear from him what motivated him to do what he did.
Hello, and thank you very much for the kind words that you've spoken. At the outset, I would like to tell you that this school, its name is Pochala, is a part of an NGO which is running in the Garhwal region of the Himalayas. And the name of the NGO is SIDH, S-I-D-H. And SIDH has been started by two friends of mine more than 26 years ago. And they have done some pioneering work in starting schools in the rural areas where none existed, and also along the way to challenge many of our assumptions about modern education. I'm also a modern educated person, and so are my friends. But in doing all this activity in the Garhwal schools, we also got a chance to look inside ourselves and to revisit the kind of education that we ourselves received. It is a small NGO in a small, sparsely populated region, the Garhwal. It was a small school. I had 126 students. It was a middle level school, which means up to class 8. And this experiment is also a small experiment, which I did for about 3.5 to 4 years. Today, when we see that the word sustainable living is come up into everyday vocabulary, I'm sure your people also have heard of it in your schools. The intellectuals at least have started to talk about it. And worldwide, everyone says that we would like to live sustainably. In this school, in the experiment that I did, even though this was not an outright objective at the beginning, combining the activities which the community was doing, integrating the activities that the children were actually performing in their daily lives at home, and trying to build a curriculum around what the community needed rather than what we should decide in the textbooks, we actually found towards the end that a kind of sustainable living curriculum can be this. It is not an end result yet, but we see a possibility. And that is the only reason that such a small experiment should have been come out in the form of a book. Because I think that possibility is important to us, to all of us, when we say that we want to live sustainably, but we are practicing doing something which are completely contrary to what sustainability demands. I've been deeply inspired by the basic education schools run by Mahatma Gandhi. And many of the things that he said were necessary for a school, I find that today it matches completely with what a sustainable community should have. So it's amazing. I mean, the great man had the foresight, and unfortunately we rejected what he had said. But without trying to copy the model that he laid out, we just took the inspiration and let that drive us. What we did was very simple actually. We said that we want self-sufficiency as an important objective in our school. If sustainability is the curriculum, then is the syllabus, then self-sufficiency is an important part of the curriculum. So we said, let us identify what are the things that we need in school, because even the school is a part of community. It is also a part of an orderly system. Right now, the school is completely separate from community. You know, what I do, or what my son does, or how he lives at home, or what background he comes from, how his parents earn their money, it is of no consequence to the school. The school gets some money, and at the end of the day, you know, it should be able to match that money and pay the teachers their fees. That is the only accounting in schools. I think if we start to do accounting in a sustainability way, then schools can actually be models. They can be islands of sustainable living. So in our school, we had these four departments that we started. One we called Himalay Heart, where we produced a lot of, we did a lot of farming and brought that back into school. So we had a lot of agricultural produce, mainly for self-consumption. But if at all we had some surplus, then we packed it, you know, to be sold and to realize some money for the school. Along with agricultural produce, we also started to study the local herbal medicines and the local knowledge inherent in tradition. Every Indian village has a lot of knowledge about agriculture, about plants and animals and rearing them and their diseases and treatment. And they have an abundant knowledge about the flora and fauna. So we thought, what the child knows, let us bring it into the school. And we started producing some Ayurvedic medicines, which we found to be very, very useful. So the first department was about food and agriculture. The second department we had, which we initially thought would be carpentry, but which later we turned out to be a complete maintenance department for the school. In our 4 years, and we have a reasonably big size school which covers about half an acre in the hills. And I think in about 4 years, I hardly recall that we called an outside person to fix something in the school more than 3 or 4 times. We had a very good, talented teacher who guided the students. And we did all our maintenance, including electrical plumbing works, building construction works on our own. We also had a tailoring department, which again was with self-sufficiency as the objective. We wanted all the children, at least the class 8 girls, to be able to stitch their own survival pieces and to be also able to help take that skill to their homes, which they actually did. And the fourth department, which was something new, which I wanted to do, considering I wonder if you know how polluting our paper industry is. And I always feel a little guilty that this book is also printed on paper which has come from that industry. But we learned to make recycled paper in school using old newspapers. It's very easy, it's possible, you know, everyone can do it. So why we did these things, a question that all my friends would ask is, to padhai nahi kar rahe ho kya? What about studies, you know? But the interesting observation at the end of 4 years I can share with you, because we are still, we maintain a relationship with all our students who are now in 10th, 11th, 12th in college. The interesting observation I find is that despite scoring high marks not being a prime objective, our children are scoring very high marks. You know, despite coming first or standing first or achieving something competitive, it was never a part of our objective, and we would never promote that. But I find that when they're going, they're topping their studies in 10th, 11th, and 12th. But yet, I admit that this is not enough of evaluation. Unfortunately, our entire evaluation mechanism is so restricted to just marks and what you do achieve, you know, in able to recall work. what we found in this kind of, when a school becomes a sustainable living community model, the opportunities for evaluation are immense. You know, you can see how I'm able to perform as in a team, how I'm able to identify things of my need, how I'm able to identify the raw materials in my environment which can fulfill that need. You can evaluate how efficiently, competently I'm able to do that. You can see a whole range of evaluations which actually complete a human being rather than, you know, keeping it very limited. These were, I think, some of the very, very small, but I think useful learnings that we have. And I think first and foremost, the teachers of the school were the first ones to actually learn all these things, which is when we also realize how much we don't know. I wonder if such things can be done elsewhere. Such a question has been posed. A message that comes out of this book probably is that it's doable in all rural areas because this was done in a rural community. But I would like to take this challenge further and ask why it cannot be done even in an urban environment. I think just because an outside company, the outside community, we have allowed it to be fragmented, doesn't mean that we can't rebuild it again. Probably somewhere schools can be a very important component.
He was saying, Venkatesh was saying, is this possible in city areas? Actually, there's a very good school in Pune, run by Vidya Patwardhan. It's called Akshar Nandan School. And that school is also based on the principle that the best learning is outside the school classroom. So for example, for geography, you know how they take geography there? They take all the students with them to the post office. Now for the students, because otherwise what students do, they sit every day on hard benches for 4 to 6 hours a day. In the end, they all get flat backsides. But basically, they take them to the post office. There, the postmaster becomes the teacher for that particular exercise. And then with the postmaster, they find out which parts of the world the letters are coming from. Then they try to identify on a globe where those countries are from and what they get from those type of countries. Then they themselves help the postmaster with identifying the names in different parts of the country where the letters have to go. And after a good visit to them, postmaster teaches them everything about postage stamps, about why postage stamps are put, what are these special postage stamp they issue on special days, and the whole business of philately, that is people who collect stamps and so on. So in just one visit to the post office, they get an entire geography lesson which they never forget for the rest of their lives. But if you study your geography with a map on a book in your school, in your room, then you're not going to learn very good geography because it's only mugging and it's putting it into your head. But once you begin to do it practically and see, then that learning stays with you for the rest of your life. And that is what I think that if you visit Akshar Nandan, you will probably be very happy. Some of the things that you tried to do at Bodhchala have been done there. Anyway, now would you have any questions to ask Rajan or Venkatesh or Therese? Come on, yes.
I would like to ask Rajan whether his book and his whole experiment has also been inspired by Tagore and Rudolf Steiner, because they have similar schools. Even in Vasco, Goa, they have a school where everything is based on activity, and probably if your approach is different, you can put light on that.
I'm not a very well-read man. I've not read too much of Tagore, though I know about his political opinions and his ideas about culture, which he has written in some essays. But no, I have not really gone deeply into what he has said school education should be. And Steiner is also another name I've heard only recently. And I have not studied what he has also.
You can have activity-based learning. Even Montessori, most of these systems are activity-based learning. because they are a reaction to what has happened in the past, where the children are fixed to a bench for 8 years of their life, and then they are incapable of getting out of that position. Then they want a job also sitting at a table for the rest of their lives. So it is a reaction to that. What he is talking about is activity, is you don't take pointless activity, you take activity which is rooted in a community. Now in a community like his, there will be farmers who will be dealing with seeds. They deal with seeds as a matter of course, because they are planting. He begins his activity with a seed bank. One of the first chapters in the book is how the school begins with a seed bank. And then how do you collect the seeds? And then what do you notice when you look at the seeds? Are they different or are they common? And how do you organize the seeds? But it's a meaningful activity because the child is familiar with the wheat, with the dals, and with the ginger and all those things, because they are part of his daily life. So whatever he's doing with that activity then fixes it in his mind. But if it's a pointless activity like with Lego toys or something or whatever, it is pointless, it's not teaching them anything. It's only doing their muscular activity. But it's not activating their mind in a creative way to link up with what's happening in the world. That's, I think that would be an answer to that. I would like to ask Terence to formally release the book, and from now on it will be available to the public. One of our books now, Learning at Bodhchala, it basically is a school which everybody would like to go to, where you don't have to sit with books and books and books, but you keep your books aside, but through your activities, you learn what the books contain. So you don't have to buy. Books are meant for dumb heads, not for picking up flesh. This book is not meant for dumb heads, it's meant for books. So it's available today at the Other India Bookstall. They've got a whole lot of other publications, including a school by Samahil, where there were no rules and the children ran the school. There are a lot of experiments going on over all the world. Only in our place they're not changing, people are not changing anything. But all over the world, the school is opening up things. Children are throwing out their teachers because their teachers are not fast enough for the students. And no lesser person than Sam Pitroda, who is a scientific advisor to the Prime Minister, he said, if I had to send my children today to school, he said, I would not do so, because the school today is actually keeping people backward and is not able to give children the ability to learn with the speed with which they want to learn. And these are all top guys in the profession. They're all top guys in the profession. So just think about it. Look at these books and see how they are transforming the whole business of learning, and it will be a great issue. So thank you very much. I must thank Terence, and I must thank Venkatesh for coming here.